Enterprise IT operations, you have to deal with a lot of different complexity. You have multiple vendors, you have switches, routers, storage from different vendors, applications, custom applications, off-the-shelf applications. So we have to be very flexible. Every enterprise is different. So we have to be very flexible in terms of like, you know, how do we collect the data from each of these application. So we wanted to have a platform or an architecture that allows us to do this dynamically. So instead of always giving, push completely new image, want it to be like very dynamic. We can add new stuff very easily, scale it very easily, because then certain enterprises may have a lot of Linux systems and maybe a fewer Windows, but in maybe in other enterprises they have more Windows and less Linux. So we want this to be scaled accordingly. So when we are looking at this, how do we satisfy this requirement? We felt microservices is the best approach because you can scale them independently. Traditional application probably go through some details on what are the difference between
microservices.
And feel free to stop. I want this to be very interactive. Anytime you have questions, because I don't know what's the level of your understanding of all this technologies, so feel free to ask any question. So when we looked at it, so we couldn't find any platform that is suited our needs. So we took a bunch of open source technologies. At some point, we also have a plan to open source this platform. So we looked at like Zookeeper, or Kafka, Elasticsearch, all these things. We kind of put together all of them and first built our platform, and then on top of it we developed our app dimension, which is our IT operation analytics plan. So as we started entering the market and deploying this into customers, they all said like, you know, we were able to, let's say they found a new Cisco source, we used to write that probe and deploy it without redeploying the whole application, and then scale it like, you know, only particular service independently. Then a lot of customers said like, you know, how are you able to do it? Like, you know, then they said like, you know, we have this platform, and a lot of people said like, you know, we also want it for our internal development. That's all. Then we kind of spinned off. But the intention of this session is not to delve too much about our platform, but you know, generic microservices platform. You know, me being a sales and marketing guy, you know, obviously there will be little bit, but I'll try to, you know, give more about the generic microservices, and then from a demo perspective, I'll show how we do it in our platform. So I think this is a classic diagram in terms of how was the evolution of your software architecture. Right? You know, traditionally, you have, you know, monolithic purpose built, very custom, and then, you know, then the tier with the Java coming and the middle tier coming. So you have a tiered architecture where there is a clear separation of, you know, application logic, the middle tier, the business logic, and then the database. then came the SOA. The SOA is like, you know, MessageBus, MuleSoft, people like MuleSoft, MessageBus came in. And then people really wanted to expose each application. Enterprises really want, you know, they develop an application, they expose it as a service, so other applications can contribute this service. But what happened in SOA is still you have a big monolithic application talking to another big monolithic application with the message bus. So the flexibility in terms of changing the application really didn't happen. So I mean, they're able to reuse some of these things and able to interact and create new business values by having this kind of interaction. But the holy grail of the developers, the fast accelerated innovation didn't happen. Because each application itself, within the SOA architecture, each component itself is a monolithic application, often. Then came the microservices. Like, you know, microservices is nothing but SOA done right. It's very much similar principles, because each each component is a service. It exposes a certain what I can do and what type of inputs I do, what type of outputs I can do. But what microservices versus model SOA is, it's very well defined. SOA didn't define what your service should be. Right? You can write a huge application and put like 100 services that it supports, and you can call it as an SOA architecture. So didn't address the scalability, independent scale. And then you must have heard about the serverless computing, which is even sort of more of a micro or nano type services. So I don't know how many people have heard about this serverless computing. You played with Lambda and AWS. So what it means is you are not dedicating any infrastructure. So it's a piece of code which gets executed whenever you want, and then it has. Typically, you do it in a lot of job type of scenarios where you execute based on a trigger or time-based trigger, and then you finish it. But so there's no infrastructure attached to it. So you have an image that gets executed on the board.
So I'm not going to into that one. But
that's where you know a lot of demand. But it's not suited for all scenarios. So it's only for certain scenarios that suits for many analytic jobs that can think or batch jobs
is where the serverless computing is. So what is the definition of microservices?
I mean a lot of people have a lot of different definitions, but this is something I like to. So it's a loosely coupled, which means it should operate on its own. It's not tied to anything. So a service that is well defined can work in any context. But it should have some boundary. It's a bounded context. It's not like you know, ever expanding. Ideally, it should be one service. Even though there is no strict guidelines saying that microservices should only support one. But a good practice is to have one clearly defined functionality or service that you know, and you should confine it as much as possible.
So why do we have to do microservices?
Why not, you know, industry, software industry has been around for a very long time, right? You know, the enterprises we have seen a lot of great enterprises formed and they all survived very well, with good applications. I mean, if you see a lot of banks, they must be using applications probably 30 years later, 30 years back, or 40 years back. Similarly, a lot of industries. You know, they are serving them quite well. But what happened is, you know, the biggest challenge with monolithic applications is the delivery cycles are very different. You know, if you have to make one change, you have to build the whole code, and you have to schedule it. You know, you have to do the whole testing, you know, the regression test. You have to do all the sanity checks. And then, you know, it's a lot of these committees, you know, they go through all the quality checks because it's risky. You know, any bug that gets introduced into the system will impact the whole application. It's not confined to one particular problem. So that is why, even though the code change or the amount of code change you have to do for introducing a new feature or addressing a bug, might be a few lines of code. But the whole process takes for you to update that into the production environment usually takes 3 to 6 months. You know, that's why you see in a lot of these cases, the releases won't happen less than 3 months or 6 months. Do you know how many releases Netflix does every day? Probably hundreds. So, maybe it goes 1,000. So they did it because they have adopted, they're probably one of the earliest pioneers of microservices architecture. And each developer oftentimes updated their service daily. So imagine how many developers they have and how many updates are. And it doesn't impact anything. So they confine to their particular piece of code, so then they can change it. And there's a lot of good practices, and I'll get into a little more details on some of the core components of what an microservices application should have to canary release. They have something called a canary release. So there's no longer patch updates. There is no longer patching. Right? In microservices world, you don't patch a particular service. You redeploy a new version. And you know, once you get confident that this new service is behaving well, so what they have this concept called selective invocation of the service. So let's say you have two versions of service. A certain traffic is directed to the new service, like maybe 2% or 5%, and then they monitor it for some time. Once they get comfortable, then they shut down the other old service. And then so there's no longer, you know, you don't patch. You always try to have a new version that is simultaneously running, and over time you kill the older version. So that is the new paradigm that is
And also, you know, performance issues. You know, one slow thing, you know, we have to address the performance issues. Oftentimes it's like a horizontal scale. You have to keep another server probably the same configuration, and you put a load balancer in.
Even though for most of the traffic is handled by one particular compiler, you have to replicate the whole stack, and then you know, that means your infrastructure costs are significantly goes up.
So I think we kind of mentioned, right, you know, the scaling is issue, the stability is issue, and the speed, you know, one of the big things, especially the digital interfaces,
they have to constantly achieve them. You can't do that in monolithic applications. It's too risky and it's too costly. So you have to put a lot of testing, rigorous testing, to really want to
repeatedly change things. So some of the principles of microservices. So a lot of it is, you know, it's very much API. So you just expose what you support. You don't have to hide. You hide pretty much everything. And they're very independently scalable. You isolate the failure.
So even if there's a bugging issue with a particular service, you only impact that particular component on the system. So you don't have the rest of the system to be like, for example, if you are running an e-commerce application. A search could be a service. A shopping cart could be a service. Payment should be a gateway service. So search, if there are certain issues with search, you know, there's only impact on that search. And you still get people to buy it, they add the shopping cart and purchase. Versus the previous cases, there's a lot to impact the whole service. So that is very important.
It's very important. And it's often modeled around business concepts.
So as I said, search is more of how you see the functionality of what it is providing, the shopping cart. So usually try to model around some of the business concepts. It's very much tied to your business stuff.
And it brings one of the big benefits, you know, apart from the modularity and the different scaling,
one of the things that a lot of these enterprises are seeing is the automation. I think probably the several things came together in terms of, you know, why this microservices is becoming popular. And for me, there are three things. One is the microservices concept. Second is the containers, and third is the cloud. So I think these are the three things that have really revolutionized the whole cloud native, what we call it as a cloud native. So you're building applications with cloud futures in mind, so which is what cloud has brought in. Compared to traditional infrastructure, what did cloud bring in? I should be able to spin up. I mean, previously people used to procure hardware, provision it, and for example, if I'm a developer and I wanted to have a machine to test my application, so it used to take, you know, I don't know, you're all probably young, much younger than me, but when I used to do development, anytime I have a lot of telecom background. Whenever we used to order a machine, these are our telecom, they have a very purpose built service. It used to take 2-3 months. Whenever we had to have a new server, the whole procurement process, and working in a big company, you know, the whole process used to take 1 to 2 months for a student to get a service. But what cloud has really brought in is instead of it. You saw what happened with Distillery, right? It's very few clicks. You select the operating system, you select what type of configuration you want, what are the features you want, and just within probably less than 2 minutes, you have the machine for you to start developing. So that is what is cloud native applications. What it means is I want to be able to do quickly things. I want to develop, package it, deploy it, bring it. So all instantaneous. So that is what we call as a cloud native application. And the fundamentals of the cloud native application are like these microservices, containers, and the rapid provision. So this is what the really this container technology, the Docker, is what it really meant. Because you know, you in the traditional days, you still create a microservices, and if you have to deploy it in a VM, it's still very cumbersome. Each microservice has its own operating system. It's still very heavy, and also a lot of issues with like portal. You have seen the snapshot. The production provides good snapshot. But the snapshot is only can be moved within another distillation. So let's say you want it to move to your machine. You can't do that. Whereas the containers makes the portability much more easy. So same container, whether it's like if you would be authorized or containerized in the service, whether it's running on your laptop or cloud, it's same. So it also gives the portability. So that is another big advantage of the cloud. This microservices plus containers plus cloud is what is the revolution in today's application development.
Any questions so far? I am probably touching a lot of concepts. If you are not familiar with this, then it may get overwhelming. But the good thing is there's a lot of platforms that hide sort of the complexity. You don't have to worry about dealing with containers. The good part of microservices is you can still use your favorite coding language. It could be Java, it could be Python, Node.js, or Rails. So most of the microservices platforms support multi-language. So you just have to write it in your own way. And you just say, package it. So underlying platform takes care of, yes, most of the platforms take care of packaging it as a container, you don't have to worry about that, you know, you have Docker installed or anything. So all the most of them give you the SDK and some environment. So you just use it, your own language, write it the way you traditionally you write your own application, old applications. A lot of this is handled by the SDKs, IDs, and the platforms. And I'll probably show you some these things. And there are, as you said, right, you have to use microservices, most of them are REST, some kind of RPC, some kind of APIs. But the problem with most of the REST APIs is your endpoints are fixed. So you're trying to give, let's say you are, and everybody has to know that you are a kind of tight cup, that's called tight cup. So let's say you have to move from my local machine to cloud, you have to update all of them. I have to tell all of the services, like now I have, you know, my service endpoint has changed, you all update it. Well, which is not really where, you know, this whole cloud native, right? It doesn't matter where my service is running, it should be independent. So that is what, where this lot of this infrastructure is coming. So service registry, concept like service registry, service lookups. So you don't tie to particular endpoint. So some of the problems with REST is these things. Or Spring frameworks. There's not a tight cup. I mean, there's, you have that modularity, but at a system level, if you look at the system level, you have that tight cup. Because you have to publish your endpoints, and everybody should know where your endpoint is. If you change your endpoint, you move from one point to another point, and it breaks your system. Instead, if you use a good infrastructure, what we call as the microservices infrastructure, which it means a service registry and message bus and service lookup, service discovery. All you have to do is a namespace. I say, you know, I am a search
surveys in Flipkart. You have to have some namespace, like Flipkart.search. And it doesn't matter, and you just look up in the service registry, say, and it gets you an endpoint. And then you call that. So that way, you know, you move to your service endpoint, and you just have to update, and it's basically most of the times the way you call the platform does this. The service itself will publish, it registers to the registry, saying that, you know, here is my new endpoint. And everybody who looks at for that service will get that update. So that way, you don't have to tie it with
infrastructure. So how are we coming in? What timing wise?
How much more do you have?
Probably another half an hour.
Yeah, you can take that. After that, you can leave, right?
Okay.
So the problem of service discovery is not something that is specific to REST.
Yes.
It can be restricted to what protocol we use, we will have.
Yes. That's true. That's why this whole, I mean, like Spring Boot and all. It's not a complete infrastructure. What I'm saying is not, you are right, it's not specific to that. But a lot of this micros, when you start going into microservices, you have to look at some of these components also. It's not like, you know, I write a service and I publish my REST API and just give it to three people. So it's easy. Like when you have like four or five different services, it's okay, you can manage it. But when you're talking about thousands of services, it's not manageable. That's where some of these infrastructure components are required, the service registry, message bus. And I'll touch upon some of the complexities of microservices. While it is easy for a developer, there are certain challenges. And the microservices has its own challenges. I'll touch upon. So what my observation is all HTTP based. RPC mechanism. Yeah, JSON. No, you can all bind objects also. I mean, at least in our case, I don't know if it's universally true. In our case, you know, the way we have done is there's a shim layer which we write it. So you just call it like another function. You don't do any, like, you know, a lot of times. You do pack, like you create a JSON and then you write, you put it in HTTP. You don't have to deal with it. So a lot of platforms hide that complexity. All you do is, you don't have to worry about where that service is. You just do another service function call, Java call. And then it could be that function call could be in some other service. So the platform takes care of all that.
So other than granularity, do you see any other differences
this way? There's a lot of these containers is one. Basically, one is biggest advantage I said is, you know, the whole packaging of microservices is containers. I mean, it doesn't have to be that, but most of the industry is moving towards that. That is giving a lot of the independent scalability. It's not just modular, but and portability.
If I may, so you're asking about the protocols, right? One of the very popular protocols that is coming up is gRPC.
Yes, RPC. Yeah, Google has come up with the GRPC.
They were using protocols before, but they ran out
of performance. I can send it later. As I said, like, you know, the biggest benefit that the services world is got is with the advent of containers. Now, suddenly your microservices became very portable, independently scalable, and it's self-contained. You have a confidence that, you know, what is working here is also working, because it's much more, and it became like, previously a lot of people used to write microservices, but they used to package in a VM, so it becomes very heavyweight. So what are the benefits? I think I think we kind of mentioned some of these things. The modularity, as you mentioned, and also slow performing issues doesn't slow your system. So any issues are isolated to that particular instance.
doesn't impact your system. So you can much more easily to address it and more becomes make your service or your application more resilient. As I said, it's much more easy to update because you have less code to deal with. Any changes are confined to that particular instance. And as I said, most of the industry is moving towards not a patching, but more of you deploy a new version of the, your service, and then you bring up, you bring down the older version once you feel comfortable with the new version. And things like API gateway, this is where the whole API gateway would come in. So most of the microservice platform also is another key component is API gateway, where they know which service version has to run. Increased stability. What are the challenges? I mean, we talked about a lot of the. What do you think could be a challenge? Just guess. Not to look at the side. Sorry?
There's a lot of complexity.
And in terms of what complexity?
In terms of infrastructure, in terms of orchestrating the services, in terms of ensuring availability.
Exactly.
It's stuff that I would not think about is possible.
Yeah. And biggest challenge is, you know, I'm sure you're all know that when you have to debug a problem, you need to go to logs and look at the logs. In monolithic, it's probably one log, right? You just have to go to one log and see, go to the sequence of things happening. And you can probably get to the get to some root cause probably easily. But when you are talking about a microservice, it's very distributed. So I call A calls B, B calls D, B calls E, and you have to go to each has its own log. Now, for you to go through all these logs, and every time I assist it into a container, I look at the log, you know, it's just impossible. And it's not easy for debugging. Right? When you're debugging, if you have a deep script, you turn on the trace and you can walk through what functions it call. But what happens if you're a distributed, right? It's very difficult to do that. So let's say I'm writing one service and you are writing another service. How do I debug that problem? How do I... So there's a lot of challenges. And oftentimes it's very dynamic to scale. Now I might have three instances now, but afternoon I probably will bring it to one and evening one. It's very dynamic. So the operational, while microservices is a boon for developer, because I can tell you, because I have left coding almost 8-9 years. One of the biggest challenges, I can still write the logic, but one of the biggest challenges is setting it up. But now with the microservices and containers, I'm only writing this small piece of code, I could probably get back and write some samples. Even though my developers don't want me to do it, but I could probably do it. So that's making it a bit easy for a developer. But the operation side is throwing a lot of challenges. Unless you have the ability to trace to a service where which service is actually slowing down your end-to-end workflow. You have to look at the so many logs. Very complex.
Testing
is not, it depends on what you're testing, but a lot of times what they're doing now is you test it in deployment because you have a older version still running. So you just do that, what is canary release. The concept in industry is called canary release, where you only test with 1% or 2% of your traffic. So in a way it's yes and no, depending upon your process and your culture. If you have to replicate the whole thing and do a regression test, you're not really getting benefit of this service, but a lot of people are going with this, I'll just push it, I'll monitor it in production, and if it doesn't work, you just roll back. So you just say, setting in the API gateway, no longer put it in the new, just put it to the older version. So.
Even from a developer's point of view, I see, from my personal experience, we faced a lot of issues trying to go to microservices. What the developer mindset has to change, they have to write asynchronous code.
Yes.
People hardly understand what that is. Everybody still needs asynchronous calls and asynchronous services.
That's true.
That is one problem. Two transactions. we need to like think of a different way to handle the SQL transactions. We shouldn't be doing the SQL transactions.
Yeah.
So there's like a whole bunch of side patterns that we need to adopt.
Yeah, stateless, that's true. Stateless and stateful are two big things. Stateless is much more easy to handle in microservices. But when you have to handle the stateful, a distributed transaction, because each one is doing certain things, and especially what happens if one goes down, what is your state of the whole system? Again, one of the things what our experience, not to highlight our platform, but in general, taking care of a friend's company, they went with the microservices. But what happened is they have to spend a lot of their time